evening, everyone. Welcome to Multipolis Mumbai Food and Our City, brought to you by Avid Learning in association with Studio X and TimeOut India.
Studio X is an initiative by Columbia University's Graduate School of Architecture, Planning and Preservation in New York. They had the idea of setting up a series of nodes globally all over the world, which investigates and explores the future of cities. So that's exactly what we've been doing for the last year and a half, whether it's architecture, urban design, or music, food tonight, and various other things like art, public art, and public policy, issues that are important to how we view the future of cities. So without further ado, I'll just pass it to Pooja to start the program. Thank you.
I would like to start this evening's program with a short video introducing you to Avid. Across literature, culture and heritage, and art, including visual, performing and applied arts, through various courses, workshops and discussion forums, Avid aspires to engage with all those who like to celebrate the living with the arts. In the same vein, Multipolis Mumbai is a platform for exchange of ideas across the worlds of art, architecture, culture, design, film, food, fashion, literature, music, philosophy and theatre, focusing mainly on a wonderfully chaotic Mumbai and its way of incubating and nurturing new forms of creativity. This series will be archived online along with highlights and video coverage of each segment, providing repository information on this glorious city. After the resounding success of our first two discussions on architecture and music, Multipolis Mumbai brings you Food and Our City. This discussion will focus on the relationship between food and Mumbai, with special focus on Mumbai's culinary history and changing avatar. We are delighted to have Rahul Arekar and Vikram Doctor in dialogue with Naresh Fernandes. I would like to take this opportunity to express gratitude to our speakers, Studio X, TimeOut India for their support, and also Naresh Fernandes, Rajiv Thakkar and Chanda Chaudhary Barai for their valuable time to put together this event. Without further ado, I would like to hand over this session to Naresh, and once again, a very warm welcome to all of you. Thank you.
Thanks everyone for coming out. Clearly food has more fans than music. This is the third installment of the series we're calling Multipolis Mumbai. And after exploring Mumbai's relationship with architecture and music, today we're going to get a sense of how Bombay, through the things we eat and how we eat them. Every great city has a certain kind of street food that seems to define it. If we can get this to work. Can you move us on to the next slide? So if you were in Berlin, you'd be eating this thing called currywurst. It's a snack of pork sausage topped with ketchup and sprinkled with a thin layer of turmeric-based curry powder. If you're Indian, it's pretty disgusting. But it's so popular in Berlin that they even opened a currywurst museum right by Checkpoint Charlie a couple of years ago. And I was in Berlin, so I went down to interview the curator, and she told me that currywurst is more than fried sausage. It's a social phenomenon, she said. It's traditional and unconventional in the same way. In New York, until recently, the most commonly available snack was the hot dog. Could we move on to the next slide? But over the last few years, as food trucks now prowl through Manhattan, they've started serving up gourmet snacks, including this thing, kimchi tacos. And it's the kind of multicultural dish that could only have been invented in New York. In Bombay, our defining street snack is, you know what that is, the vada pav. It actually isn't very old. A shop in Dadar called Mama Kane claims to have invented it only in 1971. But it's a perfect study in form and functionality, history and politics. From a nutritionist standpoint, the vada pav is a nightmare. It's a starch bomb. It's a deep-fried ball of carbohydrates tucked into a fluffy packet of more carbohydrates. This, of course, makes it perfect food for the working man. It gives you all the calories you need to fuel your day, and it's niftily constructed, so it can be consumed without any messy plates or utensils. The very name of the dish invokes more than 300 years of history. To start with, there's the pav, which is a Portuguese word. Until the arrival of the Portuguese, most Indians ate our bread unleavened. And as Salman Rushdie once noted, East is East, but yeast is West. There is another Iberian aftertaste to the vada pav. In North India, the potato is called an aloo. But in our city, we still call it a batata, which is a Portuguese word. The potato, along with the tomato and the chili, were among the products of Latin America that spread to the rest of the world only after Christopher Columbus traveled to the region. It's a process of that historians call the Colombian exchange. Over the years, you wonder what the exchange was, right? They got sexually transmitted diseases and we got corn and maize. Over the years, the vada pav has also become embroiled in local politics. The Shiv Sena has long believed that vada pav stalls on the pavement are a good way of providing employment to local youth. In recent times, the Congress and later Nitish Rane's party, the Swabhiman Sangatna, have also attempted to start vada pav stalls for their supporters. And this has brought them into conflict with the municipal corporation because most of these stalls are illegal. They've also brought them into conflict with each other. All of these elements then make the vada pav a perfect symbol for Bombay. It's zesty and it's appealing, but if you eat too much of it, it makes you pretty sick. To lead us to our discussion this evening on our city's relationship with what it eats, we couldn't have hoped for a better panel. Rahul Arekar has a master's in biochemical engineering at Columbia University. He began his culinary journey as a dishwasher in a small French bistro in New York, and went on to train in several restaurants before he returned to India in 1989. Since then, he's reinvented the Bombay restaurant scene. He opened the fabulously named Under the Over, under the Kemp's Corner flyover, which I'm sure many of you remember, and also started Just Desserts with served up jazz and puddings on Homi Modi Street. In 1999, he opened Indigo, which quickly won the reputation for being one of India's best restaurants. And as an indication of that, last year, he won the top prize at TimeOut's first food awards. What could be a better accolade? Since then, his Indigo Deli has spread across the city. Most recently, I am very pleased to report in Bandra, 5 minutes away from where I live. As I told you, right next to my auntie Irene's house. In addition to being a talented chef manager, Rahul has the ability to get even the most taciturn people to open up to him. I saw this talent in action about 8 years ago when Rahul walked me through his favorite Maharashtrian restaurants in Girgaon for an article I was writing for the inaugural issue of Time Out. Among our stops was the dearly departed Anant Ashram, run by a family that was famously set in its ways. Bombay legend has it that they once threw out the critic of the New York Times for asking too many questions. But in Rahul's presence, they not only answered all our queries, they even allowed us to shoot a few photographs of the place. Thanks for being here, Rahul. Vikram Doctor, like Rahul, has an educational background that's a little removed from food. He's an alumnus of IIM Calcutta. He's officially the marketing editor of the, of the Economic Times, but writes on a whole range of topics. but he's best known in many circles for his excellent weekly food column, in which he looks at India's food habits to understand how India is changing. He has the amazing ability to relate almost anything to food. The week of the attacks at VT and the Taj, his column was about terrorists and food. He's currently working on a book on Gandhi and food. That's two disparate things again. His interest in food has led him to collect both toy kitchens and also cookbooks. This evening he's going to use his collection of community cookbooks to tell us what the food cooked in Bombay homes by its various ethnic groups says about our city's attitude to cosmopolitanism and much more. Thanks, Vikram.
Okay, I'm supposed to start off, talk a bit, hand over to Rahul, and then we'll have a conversation. You know, when Naresh asked me to do this, he said, you talk about home food, Rahul will talk about restaurant food. Okay, which automatically made my job a lot harder. Because, you know, the truth about home cooking is that it's exactly the sort of cooking that does not get recorded. The people who do home cooking, you know, servants or housewives in the past were often illiterate. And also, their histories have never been seen as that important. So, for large chunks of time, home cooking recipes have not got recorded. This is not to say that, there are ways in which these sort of recipes can be found. But it requires a lot of like really painstaking research, you know, in sort of things like magazines and magazines and newspapers, usually Indian language magazines and newspapers. The other way to look at it is through what is called commodity histories, you know, which involves a lot of like boring analysis of market records, you know, what is sold, and then you try and make inferences about that. What's good is that people in Bombay have started doing some of it. I mean, Dr. Mohsina Mukaddam, for instance, of the Department of History at Mumbai University, is doing a fascinating study of early Marathi cookbooks, which I'm really looking forward to reading, you know, as and when she finishes that. I mean, I don't know if anybody's doing commodity histories on Bombay, but again, it's the sort of thing I hope, you know, people will do at some time. But so anyway, my problem was I had very little to go on. So what I've done is fairly random. I've chosen 10 recipes, pretty much at random. They're not meant to be representative, so I don't want some, you know, people coming saying, why didn't you have any Sindhi recipe, or, you know, something like that. They're 10 recipes I felt were vaguely interesting that said something interesting about Bombay. So we'll go through as many of them as we have time, because we may also run out of time. The dishes can always be dropped from a menu, you know, as when needed. I mean, the other thing I want to say before starting is that it's really interesting how closely Bombay is linked with food, because many of the first printed references to Bombay, the word Bombay, actually come in association with food in Garcia da Horta, because Garcia da Horta was this Portuguese scientist, doctor cum botanist, who essentially was living in Basin for some time, that's correct, yeah? Bombay, and essentially leased what is now the Bombay from the government. And he wrote this wonderful book, which really is sadly out of print, The Colloquies on the Herbs and Medicines of India, which has a few references, which are among the first printed references to Bombay. I'm going by what, you know, Jersinda Kuna, not the other Jersinda Kuna, read. And, you know, for instance, one of the first references to Bombay is he talks about how fantastic areca nuts grow on the island of Bombay. There's another wonderful reference where he's sitting at home. Most of this book is written in the form of dialogues between him and his maid servants and whoever drops in to see him, which just adds a great deal to the charm. So his maid drops in and says, like, sir, it is Sinao Toscano, your tenant of Bombayan, who brings this basket of mangoes in order that you may present them to the governor. At which point Garcia also says, and this is a very charming reaction, he says, this is fantastic, because I have mango trees which are better than this, so I can give these to the governor and keep the better ones to myself. So you can see how this sort of very deep Bombay habit of keeping the best mangoes for yourself goes back way before Bombay's founding. Okay, so let's start with the first recipe. Can we go to the first slide? The first is from a book called R.I.P. Hare's Tasty Dishes of India. Hare was a British officer who retired after independence, and basically, as he says, he got his, before he left India, he got his Khansama to write down his favorite recipes. It's an interesting book. I mean, but can we go on to the recipe? I mean, this is the one that we're looking at, is the one before, fish kitchery. I mean, I could have used many recipes for this, because this is the great Raj dish, what's better known as kejri. But uh, a, And it becomes a very elaborate dish. You know, in England, it's a classic breakfast dish, usually made with smoked, not smoked salmon, fin and haddie, which is a herring, I think, and eggs and a sort of things like that. But, you know, Arehead says it as it is. This is basically khichdi with fish added to it. And why I think this is an interesting recipe for this region is that while it was probably not invented in Bombay, it was definitely invented in this region, because the earliest references to the British eating khichdi are from the factory in Surat, where for the reasons of their health, since you know the Westerners died like flies on this coast, one of the things the authorities did was try to force them to have vegetarian days. They called them banyan days. And of course the soldiers and sailors hated it and complained about it constantly. But one of the things they had to eat during these vegetarian days was the local dish of khichdi. And at some point they started adding fish to it, because fish again has had connotations at that time in the West with fasting. So that's pretty much, I think, the most likely origin of fish khichdi. You know, khichdi becomes later on this much more elaborate dish called khichdi. The other reason I wanted to start off with this was because fish is very intrinsic to Bombay. I mean, Bombay was fishing islands, and fish has always been a key part of the city. If you look at cookbooks, you know, that are written in Bombay as opposed to cookbooks that are written in Calcutta or Chennai, the Madras cookbooks, like the most famous one, Culinary Jottings from Madras, only talk about sear fish. Okay, they don't really talk about any fish, and that is actually, if you go to Madras today, true also. All you can get is sear fish. I mean, it is one of the most frustrating things of living in Madras. In Calcutta, there's a little bit more talk. I mean, the British were very fond of a fish called mango fish, which I think is what the Bengalis call topshe. But again, not much talk of fish. Once you come to Bombay cookbooks, there's suddenly a much more deeper involvement with fish. You talk about different types of fish, like ghol, for instance, what's called rock cod sometimes. Of course, Bombay duck is the most famous one. And then there's a whole range of recipes for lobsters and oysters and crabs and prawns. And so, you know, you can see a much deeper involvement with seafood and anything to do with Bombay. What's also interesting is how fish gets involved in controversies right through Bombay's history. I mean, we're all familiar with the sort of battles that arise out of buildings these days. Paramita Vora has done that lovely documentary on it, Defeat of a Minor Goddess, about the fights between these building societies that want to be vegetarian and ban the sale of fish inside it. And, you know, it's one of these few things that puts the Sena against the BJP, which is wonderful. But one of the longest standing controversies historically, you know, in Bombay through the 17th and 18th century was over this practice called buckshaw. Buckshaw was the practice that the farmers in Bombay, especially in your neighborhood, our neighborhood of Salset, would do, was that they would fertilize the coddy and the coconut and the toddy trees by planting fish in them. Excess fish became the manure. So that was good for the trees, but it meant the whole area stank like crazy. And the British hated it. This was also, you know, apart from aesthetic objections, this was also the era of what was called the miasma theory of infection, where smells were supposed to spread like diseases. So there's this long-standing, you know, battle that keeps going back and forth between the British authorities in Bombay and their superiors in Surat about how to ban this practice of buckshaw. Okay, because it was a dilemma for the British. I mean, A, the Bombay guys didn't know how much authority they really had, Bombay being a minor dependency of Surat for a long time. Secondly, I mean, unfortunately, the coconut and the toddy trees was what provided a lot of revenue for the Bombay government, because there was a tax on coconut and a tax on toddy. And one has to remember that during all these years, Bombay was poor. Bombay was this insignificant, poor place with no real source of revenue. So things like coconuts and toddy were important. So this thing about whether to ban buckshaw, you know, goes right through. I mean, up till 1897, I found a reference in the Times of India, which talks about how finally now ice is becoming available. So then people will not use this excuse to all the inhabitants of Bandora in particular, I said, will not use this excuse to bury the fish in their gardens to fire anything. So, you know, fish and Bombay literally goes down to our roots. Can we go on to the next one? Okay, still sticking in the Bandra neighborhood. This is the East India cookery book from the Bombay East Indian Association, Paris Associated Ladies Association, which is a fantastic cookbook. And can we go into the recipe in particular? Okay, it's for, as you know, the top one, a bottle masala. How can you put the pointer? Okay, for though I don't know how many go back please. I mean, I don't know how many people here, do any people here not know what bottle masala is? Can I assume that everybody knows bottle masala? Oh, sorry, a few people don't. Okay, well, bottle masala is this standard masala blend of the East Indian community. As you can see, it involves a whole bunch of ingredients. This is actually a short recipe. I've seen recipes that add at least 10 more ingredients to it. And it gets its name because it was stored in old beer bottles. So people would make it in summer. I mean, the season just got over. And even now in Bandra, in summer, you will see, it's interesting, it's made by these Kohli women who come from the coast, and they go to these Bandra aunties, and the Bandra aunties like have, you know, carefully measured out all their, you know, because different families have different recipes, they've measured out all their things and they dry it, and then these women come and they go chuck 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 chuck, they have these long poles, and they give you your year's supply of bottle masala. Okay, it's delicious because it's warm but it's not hot. If you can get really good homemade bottle masala, you will see the difference from the few commercial varieties available. Now, what I find interesting about bottle masala, if I can get this stupid pointer to work, you know, a lot of one thing that happens as communities become more influential is this: lots of claims start getting made, and many fairly implausible claims are being made these days about the East Indian community, about its influence and its wealth and things like that. And bottle masala is used as an example of, you know, sophistication. Actually, if you look at it, what I think the recipe shows is how this was actually a very simple community, really not wealthy for most of its existence, and actually with very deep ties to its Maharashtrian roots, because the community were basically Maharashtrians who converted. If you look at the ingredients, there are a few expensive ones. There's cinnamon, there's cardamom, but by and large, the cloves. But, you know, there's no saffron, there's no nutmeg, nothing like that. Most of the other ingredients, like things like the really oddball ones, like maipathri. Maipathri is what's called mugwort or Artemisia vulgaris, which is a herb that grows wild in the Ghats, okay? Nakesar, which is, I think, this one over here, is the buds of the ironwood tree. Basically, what these are these are very common local, you know, things that grow wild, which are used in country medicine, and are just bunged in over here in this recipe. You know, just to add to it, the bulk of the recipe. Sorry, I keep doing this. The bulk of the recipe is clearly the chilies, which are Kashmiri chilies. So they're not like what we call Kashmiri chilies. So they're not very hot. And also, this part. This is really interesting. Half a kilo of wheat. Okay, that's tells you a lot, actually. I mean, the wheat is added as a filler, pretty much, to bulk up the chilies. It also acts as a thickener, because the main thing about East Indian food is that it's very simple food. You don't really often make a thick base of, you know, onions or coconut, things like that, as you do in other things. Usually just the basic ingredient with coconut milk or water, sometimes even just water sometimes added, and you need something as a thickener, which is what this wheat is providing. So I think this bottle masala really tells you a lot about the sort of community that it was. Can we? Okay, shall move on. And also the other thing is, why are you having it in bottle, you know, in large amounts? That to me says that, you know, this is a community which, and this is true of most Bombay communities for a long time. As I said, this was not a rich city until the cotton boom. You know, most families, unlike in Calcutta or somewhere like that, where you did have rich natives who were able to afford, like, you know, cooks and servants to do their cooking for them. This was not true in Bombay. The reason a family is making large amounts of, like, masala and keeping it is for, like, you know, housewives who have to do cooking for huge families, as was traditionally the case with a lot of East Indian families, or later on once they start working, you know. So this is very, it's a very practical sort of masala. Okay, Curries and Bugles, a lovely book by Jennifer Brennan, who grew up in the Raj. And the book, and the recipe I'm looking at is one of these fabled Bombay recipes called the Baikala Club Souffle. You know, this is one of these mythical things that you can hear, like, people say was lost. I mean, Rahul is laughing because he's obviously heard about it, which is all nonsense. I mean, at least like three different varieties of this recipe have been published. And basically, all this recipe comes down to is like huge amounts of alcohol. I mean, look at it. They're like, there's kumel, there's chartreuse, there's curacao, there's Benedictine. I mean, when actually, I think Naresh, we had done this for Time Out once, and we'd got Chef Ananda Solomon to make it, and he was like shocked. I mean, Now, the reason I've selected it is partly because of the Baikala Club, and which was a historic bomb institution, pretty much the first of the clubs that came afterwards. But also to point out that for a long time in this history of the city, drinking was very important. If you look at the front page of the Times of India for right through the 19th century, when of course in that time advertisements were on the front page, what you will see, yeah, well, okay, I didn't hear that. What you will see is mostly ads for alcohol. You know, ads for wine, ads for Madeira, ads for brandy. I mean, basically, the British here survived by drinking like crazy. It was the way they survived the boredom, the heat, the humidity of Bombay. Alcohol was actually seen as an important medicine. I mean, you know, Vaibhav Sharma has an interesting essay on the life of early English settlers in Bombay, where he looks at the hospital records for the first hospital, which I think was somewhere near Cooperage, the company hospital. And basically, the medicine is alcohol of different kinds. And you have these debates between the British, the board of governors, who are saying, why are you using all these imported wines like port and Madeira, etc.? Can't you just substitute this with like arrack and spices added to it? But this is, we're talking about the first hospital in Bombay. I mean, Bombay through the years, until it was stopped in its tracks by Moraji Desai, was a city that drank a lot. I mean, it drank well. I mean, not drunkenly. The irony is that the prohibition imposed by Moraji Desai is what, like, always happens in prohibition, you know, threw people into over drinking, and, you know, badly. I mean, there's this, you know, the Benedict Costa's book on Bombay. Benedict Costa was the crime reporter of the Times, right? So he's written this lurid book on the depravities of Bombay, where he talks about how the whole Bandra and Khar area, which was villages and not rich at all, suddenly had its first boom of prosperity during prohibition, because that's where everybody would go to drink. I mean, he has an interview with an old auntie, one of the aunties who would typically have, you know, alcohols underneath her bed, which she would come out and serve you, where she has a garlanded picture of Moraji Desai saying, he has brought prosperity to my whole family and my whole community. And, you know, honestly, when you see the idiocies of the excise permit regime at the moment, I mean, you have to think of things of this. And the ridiculousness of, you know, trying to control drinking in a city which has always appreciated drinking so much. The other reason I picked the Baikala Club recipe is actually because of what happened to the Baikala Club. Basically, the Baikala Club, the members at some point just decided that the land was too valuable and they sold it off. So, you know, this recipe has been lost to prohibition and real estate, which I think says a lot about Bombay. Okay, Ruchira, one of the classic Maharashtrian cookbooks. I chose from this one. This is the latest edition of Ruchira. There are several earlier editions, and again, what Dr. Mukadam is doing is analyzing how the editions have changed over time. I've chosen this particular recipe over here, Raslimbu, if you can read it. Raslimbu is a pickle, actually. It's made by Bedekers. This is actually one of the few recipes I've found for it. It's a very interesting pickle, because it's actually more like a sauce. It's made from lime juice, which is reasonably unusual. You know, people make pickle from whole lime, and usually along with Raslimbu, there's another pickle recipe for you make with the peels left over from squeezing the limes. I've chosen Raslimbu because I think it's an example of a local pickle. Every region in Bombay has its own pickles. Also, it's an example of in my writing, I do a lot of writing about foods which are disappearing for various reasons, and Raslimbu is one of them. I mean, nobody makes it any longer except Bedekers. Bedekers just stopped for a long time. For some reason, they've started making it again. I just want to tell everybody, you know, please try it. It's a fantastic pickle. It's sort of sour and sweet, but not like overpoweringly vinegary like most pickles, and it's an example of the sort of local recipes which are just disappearing. The other reason I chose Raslimbu is to do a small rant on something I rant about a lot, which is on the sheer difficulty of getting Maharashtrian food in Bombay. I mean, I really love Maharashtrian food. I mean, I'm half Gujarati, but I appreciate the elegance of Maharashtrian food, the fact that it's so healthy, that the fact that a lot of it is really interesting, you know, combinations of local ingredients and things like that, and it's almost impossible to get. You know, And we can argue about the reasons about it, and people have said that, you know, why the Maharashtrians don't want to like give their own recipes, why they don't have entrepreneurial instincts, etc., etc. But the frustration is there are this whole range of fascinating recipes, you know, different types of bakris, breads, pickles like raslimbu, you know, rice preparations, which you will, if you're lucky, you will get at homes, but never in restaurants. I mean, recently, a restaurant opened in near Rande Road in Dadar, also called Ruchira, probably from the book, which was started by a family who said that they want to revive a lot of these recipes. And it's a small, very humble place. It says Chinese, Punjabi, Maharashtrian over there, which is true for all these places. But, you know, they do have a lot of interesting recipes, like, for instance, during now that it's green mango season, there's this wonderful, I mean, it's like a dal made from green mangoes and soaked chana dal, which you grind together, and it's more like a chutney. It's fantastic stuff. They have a whole bunch of like recipes like this. So I went there, I was like, oh my God, fantastic, wonderful. I went there the second time, sorry, not on the menu. Not even through all the Maharashtrian specialities, not on the menu. I mean, this is the history of most Maharashtrian nations. I mean, Sindhudurg behind Shiv Sena Bhavan, again, is one of the best like Konkani restaurants in the town. They are, you know, I appreciate Sindhudurg because they do things like they're one of the few restaurants which has desi chicken on the menu, not the broilers that everybody serves. And they have, you know, all these interesting range of bakris, all these preparations. But you go to Sindhudurg and you ask for like, you know, Nachni bakri, not on the menu. This is the history of Maharashtrian restaurants, and it is intensely frustrating. I've just added one more recipe from Ruchira, this one really, which actually reads perfection salad. I just threw this in as an, it's an interest. I just threw this in because I want to make a point over here. You know, cookbooks like Ruchira or, you know, Samay Tupar, the great Tamil Brahmin cookbook, today they often have this reputation of being these ultra-traditional, ultra, you know, ultra-historical sort of things, when in fact they're nothing of the kind. These sort of cookbooks are often extremely progressive for their time. The women who made them were often, if you look at their histories, like if you trace their histories, which I don't know Kamla Bai Ogle's history, but I do know about Meenakshi Ammal, who did Samay Tupar. These were extraordinary women, you know, who had to overcome a lot of diversity, a lot of problems in their lives, and actually do something radical for their time in creating a cookbooks. And many of them have very modern recipes. Perfection salad is basically an American gelatin salad. I mean, it's actually familiar. It's actually quite famous from mid-century American cooking. And I found it fascinating that, you know, it's there in Ruchira. So, but anyway, that's not really a Bombay recipe. So, okay. This is one of my favorite cookbooks, the Time and Talent Club cookbook, which is one of these great classic cookbooks put together by a bunch of, like, I guess, mostly South Bombay ladies. You still have to get it from the Time and Talents Club. And its recipes are really quite unique. And I was looking through it, trying to find, like, a recipe that would encapsulate the sort of style of the Time and Talents Club, and I found this one. Kidney and egg meringue. Okay, now that says everything about, I mean, you have unusual ingredients, combinations, kidneys and eggs, with a sort of, you know, fanciful preparation. If you read it, you know, you have to make a meringue, and you have to put, now, I haven't chosen this to make fun of the Time and Talents Club, because I'll tell you one other thing about it. The recipes are fantastic. They're dead delicious. They may sound awful, they may sound weird, they may sound unhealthy, they may not be fashionable for today, but they all taste fantastic. The other reason I picked this was because what people don't realize, but if you look at old Mumbai cookbooks, there's a long tradition of eating offal, of eating all these other ends and odds of meat, okay? The first khanewals in Bombay were from the Bhandari community, who have a long tradition of cooking like offal dishes like bajri, tripe, etc. These restaurants have mostly vanished, though I think Puripur, Kolhapur has just started again, and they do have a few dishes like tripe on their menu. But if you look at the East Indian cookbook, again, that has like heads, trotters, things like that. You look at some of the early cookbooks like Mrs. Bartley's Indian Housekeeper General, the third recipe is sheep's head broth. I mean, right through, you know, the early Bombay cookbooks, you have this huge range of offal dishes, nearly all of which are vanishing today. Because, and this again is something, you know, I keep wanting to emphasize that unless we engage with food, unless, you know, there's a living tradition behind food, it tends to vanish. What is happening with offal dishes today is because the knowledge is vanishing. People are, you know, people are not passing on the knowledge of how to cook these dishes. then, you know, people also get the impression that these are weird, squeamish, like sort of like unpleasant dishes, so they don't like cook these dishes to begin with. And then shops stop cooking them. I mean, in Bandra, for instance, the last 5 or 6 years, we've seen a steady disappearance of most independent butcher shops, which would be the only places where you would get like all these like awful meats. You're not going to find like brain and like a tripe in Nature's Basket. I mean, not that there's anything wrong with Nature's Basket. I shop there all the time, but this is the fact. So once these meats, the only way people, most people engage with awful meats these days is during Ramzan, when they go to Muhammad Ali Road and they say, and it becomes a dare. Oh my God, I ate like tongue, I ate like Gurda Kapura, etc. But the problem with doing it that way is A, you're not doing it regularly, and B, it's horrible. I mean, one of the biggest cons in Bombay is this whole Muhammad Ali Road experience. I mean, everybody thinks they're going there to eat good food, and they're going there to eat like crap food, overpriced, you know, produced every year by these guys who just like dish it out, but they're not, you know, they're not really good cooks. I mean, the tongue soup in particular is disgusting. I mean, because they just get these goat's tongues and chop them up, and it's like eating like, you know, and without even skinning the tongue, so it's like eating like condoms flavored with maybe filled with meat. You know, it's truly disgusting. So you know, again, this is a problem, that this whole range of awful dishes is disappearing from our lives. Okay, I need to speed up, so I'll hurry through. This is a lovely book, a recent book, Anil Fajapura King's My Bombay Kitchen, which talks about Parsi home cooking. She has a fantastic recipe in this, green chutney souffle. This is from the, as she said, it's from, I chose it partly tribute to Jahangir and Shirin Sabawala, who, you know, whose speciality this is. But again, it's, as she points out in the book, it's a very Bombay sort of recipe. It takes something Gujarati, that is green chutney, which is given a Parsi touch, so it becomes Parsi green chutney, and you make a souffle out of it. And this I've actually made, and it's fantastic. I mean, Rahul makes a lot of souffles at Indigo. I don't know if you've ever done anything like this. Yeah. So I thought this was a wonderful synthesis thing. Katie Dalal's, she died a couple of years back, really sadly, but her two Jamwa Chaloji books are fantastic collections of, you know, really obscure original Parsi recipes. They have a recipe for toddy mutton, which is one of the things I would most like to make, because the recipe starts with saying, take 7 bottles of toddy slightly on the sweetish side. I mean, who would not want to make a recipe like that? But the recipe I've actually chosen from this book is Dharni Puri. Because, you know, this is interesting, because one of the interesting things we see with all the communities in Bombay is how many of them respond to the same recipe, same idea, in many different ways. Dharni Puri, basically the Puran Puri concept of a besan sort of stuffing inside a bread, is made by Maharashtrians in the dry form, which you can eat like either with milk or with coconut milk, you know, depending on things like that. It's made by Gujaratis in the sort of really rich ghee-soaked form. It's made really interestingly by the Beni Israelis in two ways, in a way that uses oil, in a way that uses ghee. Because being Jewish, they maintain the distinction of meat versus dairy, depending on what their meals are. So they make two versions. And finally, you have this Parsi version, which they've actually made it into a cake. It's like a thick cake. Which, as she says at the end, cut into wedges and serve hot with tea. I mean, I find this fascinating, the way these sort of recipes change. I couldn't resist adding another recipe from Katie's book, Govar Singh Ne Ghar Apne Patia. This is cluster beans cooked with bhingi fish roe. I chose this because, as I started by saying, you know, Bombay recipes traditionally have a huge interaction with the fish in this region. We knew not just fish in general, but the different types of fish, the fish parts, how to use fish head, how to use fish roe, you know, how to use different fishes in different ways. And this again is knowledge that is disappearing, you know, because as restaurants serve pomfret surmai ravas, I mean, almost that's it. I mean, all the amazing range of fish that you get in this region is disappearing bit by, I mean, the knowledge of how to cook it is disappearing bit by bit, even though all of it is some of the cheapest fish in the market. The other sort of interesting thing about this book, this recipe, is that it's characteristic of a whole range of home cooking dishes, which are vegetables flavored with a little bit of meat and a little bit of fish. And these, again, are dishes which many of us know from our youth, but which are vanishing because they don't fall into this dichotomy we have these days of vegetarian, non-vegetarian. You know, if a dish is non-vegetarian, it has to be like meat full. And if it has to be vegetarian, it's like vegetables and no meat at all. So these what I call semi-vegetarian dishes are just sort of vanishing between the crack. Restaurants don't serve them, and it's a real loss because they are delicious and healthy dishes. Okay, just a last stretch. Naresh is getting a thing like that. This is from a series of four small cookbooks published by Inquilab newspaper, which I chose this because these were really booklets. Okay, there was one on Memon cooking, there's one on Konkani Muslim cooking, there's one on Bora cooking, and there's one on Kashmiri cooking. These were, sold at the newsstands. I've never seen them in bookshops. They were just done like they were Inquilab and sold really cheaply on newsstands. It's an example of the sort of ephemera that a lot of like food writing is reduced to. And I also chose it because there's a huge lack of knowledge of Muslim home cooking in this city. Unfortunately, what happens with Muslim cooking is it gets dominated by the sort of Muhammad Ali Road places, which are run by guys who may or may not be good cooks, or it's dominated by biryani, which is one single horrible dish. I loathe biryani because it just obliterates everything. Whereas at the expense of really home-cooked recipes like this, I mean, this is one I just chose at random, randlili roti. I mean, this is actually a really interesting dish. I mean, unfortunately, this is the book follows the sort of Urdu tradition, so you read it from right to left, so he hasn't scanned the English part. But basically what this dish is, it's partly Gujarati, the bajra flour, you make bajra flour rotis, and then these are soaked along with the mutton dishes, which makes it a type of Arab Islamic dish called a tharid dish, which is very important in Islam because the Prophet is said to have liked tharid dishes a lot. So if you look across the Islamic world, you'll find many of these so-called tharid dishes, which involve breads soaked, cooked along with meats. And I was just fascinated to find what seems to be an example of a tharid dish in a Bombay home cooking like recipe book. Dadi Manam Warso, another amazing book, a recent book, from Palanpuri Jain Ladies Association, one of the most amazing cookbooks produced in Bombay. This book is really a labor of love. It was spearheaded by a lady called Dr. Satyavati Javeri, and it is a portrait of a community. That's what it's meant to be. Luckily, these sort of community cookbooks, like the East Indian cookbook, tend to be very cheap, not very well done affairs. Because the Palanpuris are diamond merchants and have the money, they really put in the effort and expense over here, and they've come up with this incredible cookbook, which you actually, if you want to buy it, you have to go to a jeweler shop. There's one jeweler shop in Eros, Suraj Mal Laluchand, who you call Niyati, who runs it, and she will get a cookbook for you. I mean, that's how you get it. The recipe I chose is Kher Sangri Kumuntia, simply because of what it does. I mean, it brings up, all these oddball ingredients, which are specific to particular communities. And this again is something you see very much in Bombay, that each community has its own vegetables which are only available in certain neighborhoods. If you want breadfruit, you have to go to Matunga because there's one guy who sells breadfruit which the Mangaloreans like cook. I mean, I have only found Kardikapatha, which is safflower leaves, which are a fantastic green for putting in curries, only in mill areas dominated by people, from the interior Maharashtra, from Vidarbha district. Every community, area you go to, which still is dominated by community, will have its own greens, and this is something that remains in Bombay today. And I think how long it will remain, I have no idea, but I think it's fascinating. The most fascinating bhaji of all is actually found sometimes in Grant Road in Bhaji Gully, which is called Morris Bhaji, which is the weirdest bhaji I've ever found in Bombay. It grows in the mangroves. It's actually salty. It's like a succulent salty bhaji. And I was told by the guy who was selling it that the reason is, many of these are used for ritual purposes, which again is the reason why a lot of recipes survive. So this Morris Bhaji is used by young Gujarati women who are unmarried, who are keeping a salt-free breath in order to get a good husband. But this is a slight cheat that you can do. You can eat Morris Bhaji and you can get a little bit of salt by it. I mean, how long most of these vegetables are going to last is no idea. But at least with the Palanpuri community, because they have the benefit of being rich and because there is a demand for it from across the world, these sort of dishes will survive. The last one I don't have a recipe for, I don't have a picture for, but I do have the actual thing which I'm going to ask them to give out, which is a recent addition to the city. It's this snack that some of you may have had called dosa khakras. Dosa khakras are amazing, okay? So I'm passing out some of it, so please try it if you haven't had it. For those of you who haven't seen it, a dosa khakra is a dosa dried like a khakra. And it is fascinating, okay? From me, having grown up in South India, I could not believe it. I mean, this is a dosa which was like a khakra. And then it seems to have come up in Matunga, which is the one area which is dominated by both Gujaratis and like and Tamilians. And, you know, there are multiple stories involved in this. And even though Naresh is breathing down my neck, I'm just going to tell you a few of them. Story number one is how the Gujarati community took to idlis and dosas. And that really starts, you know, about 40 years back when one particular lady, but there were others like her, called Gomti Murthy, comes to Bombay from Coimbatore. And she brings with her as a young bride this hot new, you know, invention in Tamil Nadu, which is a wet grinder. Okay, and very few people in Bombay had wet grinders at that time. So she has a wet grinder, she sets it up and she's making it for her family. Her husband loses her job at some point, and just to make ends meet, and this is again a very typical Bombay story. This is how a lot of food gets out there, how housewives get into the marketplace in Bombay. She starts making idlis, which her husband starts going, taking down to all the buildings around Nariman Point and starts selling the idlis. And her husband has a Gujarati friend called Naveen Bhai, who tells her at one point, you know, these idlis are fine, but why don't you actually sell the batter? Because the Gujaratis, above all, took to idlis and dosas hugely, because it was vegetarian. So she started doing it in little plastic packets of batter just around the Matunga area, and it was an immediate success. And she started doing so well that, again under Naveen Bhai's guidance, because again you needed a Gujarati to help you with this, she applied to a role to Syndicate Bank, and she gets a loan. And you know, Rahul just reminds me over here, Rahul being over here, that I don't think many people realize that Rahul was starting Indigo. You started on the basis of Saraswat Bank. No. Saraswat and Syndicate Bank, yeah. So, you know, these sort of bank loans from small banks have a lot to do with food. So she starts selling it, and it really takes off. And suddenly you have this whole concept of Matunga Mavu, which you know, the Gujaratis have from. Now, the biggest supplier, even bigger than Gomti Murthy, I'm told, is a place called Jain and Iyer. Jain and Iyer, you know, that says everything you need to know about Matunga. And at some point, somebody among the Gujarati community, because it's certainly not the South Indians who've done this, came up with this idea of creating this, of drying this and using it. What you may not realize, though, is that the innovation here, I think, is not the khakra, but the box. Because the box is what makes the product possible. Something as fragile as this is just not going to last. Even khakras, which are much thicker, you know, usually break a little bit when you tell them. Something as fragile as this is only possible with the box. And it was this idea of coming up with a box which really creates this as a product. And this is something you see in Bombay often, you know, these small touches. The other great example I know is the Tibbs Frankie. Okay, you know, lots of claims have been made for how Tibbs Frankies are the original like roll, etc., which is nonsense. Anywhere in the world where you have flatbreads, you're going to have rolls of some kind. The innovation in the Tibbs Frankie is actually the plastic sleeve. The plastic sleeve that's closed at one end. Because that's what enables him to put in a much more liquidy filling. You know, otherwise it'll just all just drip out. Anyway, half of it drips out half the time. But at least having that plastic sleeve at the end, you know, allows you to eat it with a modicum of thing. And that, for me, you know, symbolizes a lot of what is true about food in Bombay. Other cities have inventive food cultures. Delhi's, you know, Chandni Chowk food is incredibly inventive. But it's these things, like the plastic box, the plastic sleeve, to commercialize it, which really is what makes food, I think, in Bombay viable and interesting.
Thank you, Vikram. That was fascinating. And after this, I'm going to Mamandali Road to have a biryani.